Hello again. So in this episode, I'm going to revisit, or we're going to rediscuss some of the basics of SE Linux, because I noticed that some people, or many people actually, still don't grasp my examples because they lack the basically the default knowledge of the default concepts of SE Linux. Now, I'm for years trying to write a book about SE Linux, and it's basically stagnant. It's not, but I did start on the first chapter, which basically prepares the reader for the remainder of the book. And so I'd like to just in this video basically discuss the first chapter, and hopefully that'll give you a better insight, basically a pretty solid base about SE Linux, and helps you understand why I'm using various stuff that I'm using. But you'll have to know that this is basically, the first chapter is basically meant as a rough overview. So it's going to mention a lot of concepts, a lot of lingo and stuff like that, but you aren't expected to actually know the technical details about it. That's not the intention of the chapter. The chapter is just to touch on the various concepts and lingo, and basically give you a short, brief explanation of what it does. And then later in the book, in the other chapters, we're going to build on that and explain further how all these bits and pieces fall into place. So I call this chapter SE Linux in a nutshell, chapter one. And basically, what it says here is this chapter serves as an overview of SE Linux. We expect the reader to already have a basic understanding of SE Linux, but because it is important to establish a solid basis for the remainder of this book, we will briefly touch on the important concepts of SE Linux. So that's basically what I said. We're just touching on the concepts, but we're not going to dig really deep in it. So some of the things that I think one should, or yeah, what I think one should know about SE Linux in order to have a solid basis to build on. So let's see if I can basically increase the font size. So the case for SE Linux. So this is basically, this title is basically borrowed from the maintainer of SE Linux and SE Android. He uses the case for SE Android to basically demonstrate the use of SE Android, but I just changed that to the case for SE Linux because it's just such a great title. So what I'm saying here is, before you can use SE Linux to its full extent, you need to know what it aims to provide. What is the rationale behind SE Linux? What are the fundamental weaknesses of traditional Linux security, and how does SE Linux address these challenges? What makes SE Linux a better mandatory access control security framework? So in this section, or I think this section is one of the most important sections to fully grasp. The information in this section also enables you to make a solid case for SE Linux. So basically, what I'm saying is, the use of SE Linux, you need to basically know how to explain that in simple terms, whether it be for yourself or whether it is to basically explain to your boss why we should implement SE Linux, why we should use SE Linux. So I'm going to help in this section. The case for SE Linux is going to help you basically do that. And then there's like couple of like five subsections. So there's like 5 points you should know. If I ask you why should we implement SE Linux, then you should basically know 5 points. And the first point, I called it the inevitability of failures. It's a tough word. And this basically is just a simple introduction. where I'm talking about a paper that was published by the National Security Agency back in 1998, and it was called The Inevitability of Failure, the Flawed Assumption of Security in Modern Computer Systems. And basically this paper, and I can see if I can go there, this paper, you should read it, and you should have a copy of it on your computer. This paper basically discusses that, or it discusses a lot of things, but the main takeaway from this paper, for this chapter, is basically that you can't trust programs and you can't trust users, simply because programs are coded by people, by humans, and humans make mistakes, and humans can be malicious. So programs are basically an extension of users. So you can't trust them. You can't trust users. They make mistakes. Sometimes I accidentally do an RMRF in a directory that I just didn't realize that I was there, and I'm deleting stuff that I shouldn't have deleted, and it can cause major damage. But the point is that we need a secure operating system to deal with that. So we need to be able to deal with the insecure programs and the mistakes that people make, and malicious people, on another level, not on the application level, because we can't trust the application and we can't trust the user, so we can't do that on the user level. We really need to do it on the level below the application, which is the operating system level, the secure operating systems. So the need for secure operating systems. So that's basically what we're saying here, is we need security on an operating system level. That's basically all it said, because we can't trust applications and humans. Then the next chapter goes, and it's titled DAC versus MAC, discretionary access control, which is traditional Linux security, versus and mandatory access control, which is, as Linux is a form of, or implements a form of mandatory access control, flexible mandatory access control to be exact. So I start saying by choosing the title for this section was a bit of a dilemma for me. I was unsure whether to use the current title or use decentralized versus centralized security. They both basically mean the same. So let me explain that. So discretionary access control, I'm not sure if you are, and I hope you are aware of traditional Linux security, where system resources are owned by a user ID and by a group ID, and then you have the permission bits, the read, write, execute, read, write, execute, read, write, execute. So if you create a file or you create a process, then basically your user ID and group ID are assigned to that system resource, and that allows you to basically change the security attributes of the system resource, which basically provides you, or gives you, the discretion to change the security attributes of your system resource. So basically you are the security administrator of that particular system resource, and that's inherently a problem, because nowadays you have these shared computer systems where basically, for example, you go to your work and you work on your computer there, and basically you create a file on behalf of your boss, because, well, you work for him, and although you write the file, you don't actually own it, the company owns it. And well, let's say you change the permissions to world readable, and some hacker comes in and he reads your company's confidential file. Okay, it's written by you and created by you, and thus you have the discretion over the security attributes, but you don't really own it. So your boss wants a way to be able to override the discretionary aspect of traditional Linux security. He wants to be able to say, okay, I own that file, you created it on my computer, and in my time I pay you for it, I own the file, so I want to be able on a system operating system level be able to decide what the security attributes should be and what who can access it and stuff like that. So decentralized, I mean discretionary. Basically each user ID has discretion over the security of their system resource, versus centralized, where basically all security is done from a central place, in this case by the security administrator or the system administrator, the one who has the authority to basically change system-wide policy. So that's basically what I'm saying here. We need a way to basically override the discretionary access controls with a mandatory access, with mandatory access controls. So that's basically why ASI Linux is built, is an additional layer on top of traditional Linux security. So in ASI Linux systems you still have to deal with traditional Linux security, which you still see your user ID and group ID, and you still see the bits, and to a large extent it's still you can still set it and it still behaves the same. But the mandatory access control ASI Linux basically allows you to override it. It doesn't mean you have to override it, you can still leave some to the discretion of the user ID owning the system resource, but it allows you to basically override it. And so it just depends on whoever designed the policy to decide whether the user has some discretion, or the user ID of the owner of a system resource has some discretion over deciding the security attributes of the system resource or not. So traditional Linux security is based on an identity-based discretionary access control model. With the identity based, we're referring to the group ID and the user ID. So that's the identity based part of it. System resources are owned by users. Now that's what I told you. System resources are assigned to user ID and the group ID of the user process that created it, of the process that created it. And these users can govern access to their resources at their discretion. So that's basically what I'm saying. You create a file, you create a file, to keep it simple. Your user ID and group ID are assigned to that file, and you are able to set the bits to your discretion. So you can basically tmod 777 and make it world readable, world read writable. The problem here is that users or programs that execute tasks on behalf of users can't always be trusted. So that's where I'm basically touching on the fact that you might be working on a file that you created but you don't actually own. For example, your company owns it and you are creating it on behalf of your company, and that there is a need to govern access to system resources from a central place, aka mandatory access control. So you want to do it from an operating system level, from a central. You want to give the actual owner of the system, or the actual human that is authorized to control security of the full system, rather than the owner of a system resource, or of a single system resource. So mandatory access control enables for system-wide security policy, rather than file-wide or user-wide, overriding traditional Linux identity-based access control. ASI Linux sits below the traditional Linux security, so this is important to understand, and I already touched on that as well. It sits below traditional Linux security. So basically, first the system checks the traditional user ID, group ID, and permission bits, and then it checks ASI Linux. So although you might have access from a traditional Linux security perspective, ASI Linux can still override that. If ASI Linux says no, but traditional Linux says yes, then it's no, because first traditional Linux security is checked, and then ASI Linux is checked. So ASI Linux complements traditional Linux security. It's not something separate. They complement each other. Well, ASI Linux complements discretionary access control. ASI Linux is aware that that traditional Linux security is there, but traditional Linux security isn't necessarily aware that ASI Linux is there. So, if so, this means that ASI Linux system-wide policy can, comma, if so desired, comma, override governance or part thereof of access to system resources. So, so if you have ASI Linux, that doesn't mean that you can't, that users, single users, don't have any discretion anymore. You can still implement a policy in which you give your users the discretion to change their security, but you don't have to. It allows you to override it or parts thereof. Security policy is enforced centrally, so that's basically the main thing. Centralized security versus decentralized security, tech versus Mac. ASI Linux complements traditional security. This is important to always consider, so always remember that you'll also deal with traditional Linux security even in an ASI Linux system. You'll have to be aware of both security frameworks, security systems. ASI Linux sits below traditional Linux security, so also know that first traditional Linux security is checked and then ASI Linux is checked, not the other way around. That means that when a process, when access is requested, that first the traditional Linux security attributes are checked, only after that ASI Linux is checked. So that's what I was saying. This is nice because you can implement partly centralized security policy. So that's where I'm what I'm saying with you don't have to basically override the traditional security or parts thereof. You can just do parts or not override it at all if you wanted it. Although that doesn't make sense, of course, but in some cases you want to give the user still some discretion. So, and leave other things to the at the discretion of the process. Implementing ASI Linux does not mean that traditional Linux security no longer applies. It means that it enables you to override it or parts of it on a system-wide level. So, pretty important concept to understand. Alright, section 3 of chapter 1. So ASI Linux and integrity. Basically, you could call this enforcing integrity, so to speak. So another fundamental weakness of traditional Linux security is that applications that execute tasks on behalf of users have full access to user resources and access privileges. So I hope you understand this sentence without me basically explaining it, but I can basically explain it. So let's do a PSX. Each of these processes, from a traditional Linux security perspective, run as me, because I basically executed these programs, and these programs, these agents do tasks on behalf of me. Now, in a discretionary access in a traditional Linux security world, they just basically inherit the permissions of the parent. So each of these processes have discretion over system resources that are owned by the same user, the same group. So they can, so basically my IRC daemon, my IRC client, can basically govern the security of the content of my MUT message mail user agent. And you probably don't want that, because if your IRC client is compromised, then you wouldn't want your compromised IRC client to be able to manipulate your emails, which might be sent by with MUT. So that's an inherent problem that all these processes basically have the full user access. They have more privileges than they need. An email program just needs to be able to, an email mail user engine just needs to be able to send and receive email and store emails, and that's it. But it has much more permissions than it actually needs to do its job. And it's just like with, for example, with everything in life, the more you have, the more that can break. So you keep it simple and keep it to the point, so that gives you less chances that you'll break anything, because the more you have, the more it can break. And so that's a fundamental problem with traditional Linux security, is that all these processes have all these permissions and they just don't need them all. So that's so this means that we rely on the application to be flawless and on the good intentions of the author of the application. We also have to rely on our own competence. One mistake can have big consequences. So that's what I meant with you by accident run an rm-rf/, for example. And so the application, we rely on the application to be flawless, so that it doesn't do something that that it shouldn't do. Because from a traditional Linux security perspective, it has way more permissions than it actually needs. So if the program was had a flaw that would affect something unrelated to the program itself, or maybe even related, then yeah, it can mess up the system, because well, security allows it. While it in a perfect world, it shouldn't even need those privileges to do the bad stuff or to make the mistake. If you can't make a mistake, then well, then the problem is solved. But if you basically from a security perspective can make a mistake, then it's only a matter of making a mistake, and then you're basically done, screwed. And well, one mistake can have big consequences. So that's also boils down again to the first section of the first chapter. Basically, you can't trust users and applications, and you need security on the operating system level. Basically, you need to have that security on a higher level, or on a lower level. I'm not sure how you. So, as in Linux, enabled processes to be restricted. So that's basically something that we'll discuss later in the book. But that's basically one of the things that as in Linux does. It enforces integrity, and it basically can split up all these processes and basically give them all a unique identifier. Or a set of unique identifiers, better said, and then basically it allows you to specify what each identifier can do. And so if you can imagine that each of these system resources has a unique identifier, even each system resource on a system has a unique identifier, and you are allowed to how each identifier is able to operate or interact with another identifier on a pretty fine-grained level, then you can maybe imagine how flexible and how fine-grained you can specify what a process should be able to do to what system resource. So you can basically give the process exactly the permissions that it needs to do its job. Nothing more, nothing less. And that's basically where SE Linux tries to solve the problem of DAC, of traditional Linux security. Linux security is too coarse, where basically you run a program and that program runs with all your permissions, and which are access permissions for the program, because it only needs to do a specific task, and you give it way more privileges. And as Linux basically assigns these sets of identifiers to each process, unique identifiers to each process and files on the system, and then allows you on a system-wide level to specify how each identifier can operate or interact. And that allows you to actually tailor the permissions to each unique process if you wanted to. It doesn't say you have to, but it allows you to do it. Alright, so I hope that so then I go on to say that SE Linux enables processes to be restricted and allows us to contain impact of a process on the operating system level. So that's basically what SE Linux does. It contains effects. It basically builds a wall around a process, and so if the process is compromised, which still can happen, then it still cannot break out of the wall. So, and I will go on later in the next paragraph about more about that. And damage that a process can do can be contained. SE Linux enables the enforcement of integrity. So by containing that, you enforce integrity. You basically, it enables you to say, okay, this process can only do this and that and that. We can be sure of that. So we can enforce integrity that it doesn't escalate to outside of its walls, so to speak. So in the past, the analogy of a submarine was used to clarify this. I just added this paragraph because of that analogy still, I still think that's a nice analogy. So a submarine is built of compartments. And if one compartment takes water, then the compartments contain the damage. So yes, there will be damage, but the damage will be contained. And chances are that the submarine will not sink as a whole. You should think of SE Linux in the same way. It can be used to contain damage that a process can do. If a process is compromised and SE Linux contained it, then you may not have to replace the whole system. And you may not have to worry about the process affecting other system resources. So, containment. Integrity, containment. And preventing access privileges. The more you have, the more can go wrong. Okay, so next chapter, next section 4, SE Linux and confidentiality, enforcing confidentiality. So this is basically optional. SE Linux enables for the control of the flow of information in shared computer systems. So this basically has to do with the multi-level security, which we'll delve in later. You have probably haven't heard of that abbreviation yet, but it basically just make a note that SE Linux can enforce confidentiality, aka SE Linux can enable you for the flow of control of information in shared computer systems. System resources are assigned sensitivities, and processes with higher sensitivities are not allowed to write to system resources with lower sensitivities, or are not allowed to interact with processes on with lower sensitivities. Both processes with lower sensitivities are not allowed to read system resources with higher sensitivities, and that also goes for that's basically well said. This allows for enforcement of confidentiality on an operating system level. So you have the shared computer system with various users, but each user, one user, or so to speak, not all users are created equal. So basically, the more important user you assign with a higher sensitivity, and the lower important, less important guy you assign with low sensitivity, they both work on the same system, but the guy with the low sensitivity is not aware that the guy with the high sensitivity is on the system, And the guy with the high sensitivity is aware that the guy with the low sensitivity is on the system, but he is not allowed to basically talk to the guy with low sensitivity, at least not by default. You can basically you could override it, but that will break the system. But the point is that important information does not leak to less important persons. So you'll basically classify your information on the system. In this case, as Linux provides something that traditional Linux security could not. So basically, the traditional Linux security doesn't allow you the enforcement of the flow or the control of the flow of information. It just doesn't, just isn't aware of that need, and it doesn't provide any way to do that. Now, some applications do that, can do that. For I think in the Windows world, and probably maybe also in the Linux world, there are applications that have that idea of enforcing confidentiality built in, but. Like I said in the previous section, you can't trust applications, so you really need to do that on a system, operating system level, and as Linux does it on operating system level. So, and additionally, it does so on an operating system level, that's what I said. Implementing this on an application level instead would force us to rely on the integrity of the application, and that's basically what I'm saying. You could basically build in the control of flow of the flow of information in a application, but then you'd have to rely that the application is not flawed or compromised. And as Linux does it on a system-wide level, and so that's another advantage. Alright, section 5, as Linux flexible and configurable Mac. So compared, that's the last point, compared to traditional mandatory access controls like, for example, on SunOS, I think, as Linux is flexible and configurable. So basically what, and again, the details will become clear later in the book, but it's just that you know that it's additionally flexible and configurable. It's not just Mac, it is flexible and configurable Mac. So this is basically the flexible and the configurable part, is basically the plus of Mac versus traditional Mac. So as Linux is flexible and configurable, as Linux policy is managed from a central location and enables the person responsible for responsible to create identifiers and assign identifiers to system resources and to write policy that governs access to these resources that have these identifiers assigned. And that goes a little bit beyond where it should go right now. You should just know that the difference between traditional Mac and as Linux Mac is that as Linux is also flexible and configurable. Alright, so this is where as Linux is different compared to traditional mandatory access control systems. So that's what I said. As a security administrator, you have the flexibility to classify system resources, specify system-wide security policy that is as fine-grained or coarse-grained as you like, enabling you to restrict processes or groups of processes in whichever way you like. So it provides a huge flexibility and configurability. I've heard some people argue that SE Linux is complex in the past. I do not agree with that assessment. Relatively speaking, SE Linux is as complex or simple as the policy you choose to enforce. In my view, SE Linux is flexible, but it does not have to be complex, relatively speaking. SE Linux does, however, expose the complexity of GNU/SE Linux. So what I'm saying is, sure, as Linux has some stuff you need to understand, and to understand it is not really easy because it's all tied in with one, security, and two, Linux. systems, because you're trying to solve a Linux security problem. So you're not just dealing with ASI Linux and the technical aspects of ASI Linux, but you're also dealing with security, because you're applying security to a Linux system. And you also need to know Linux, because you know you need to know what you secure. If you don't know what the hell you're trying to secure, then it's hard to secure. And that's also, I am not a Linux coder, so for me it's really harder to secure a Linux system than it is for someone that does Linux application or kernel coding, because he just knows more about the stuff that you're trying to secure. And on the other hand, someone that is that really knows the job of securing stuff, that also has an advantage over someone who doesn't know how to secure anything. If you don't know how to identify what you're trying to secure from and how you approach that, then you have a problem. So it's not just about ASI Linux, it's about all these three aspects: ASI Linux, Linux, and security. You put that all together and then stuff becomes really complex, of course. But ASI Linux really itself, the mechanism is very simple, I dare to say, compared to the issues it's trying to help you solve. And you can only see that if you see, at least I think that you can only appreciate that if you appreciate the whole picture of the fact that it's not just about ASI Linux, but it's also about security and Linux, and actually also about the human aspect, because there's still humans interacting and operating, operating and interacting with Linux. So you also need to know a little bit about the human aspect of security. So that's basically what I'm trying to say in this last paragraph. All right, so I think we're done with section one. So there's these five things that you need to know how to basically sell ASI Linux to yourself or to your boss or to anyone else. The strong points and the weaknesses that it's trying to address in the discretionary access control traditional Linux security. Alright, now this should be the next chapter, identifying Linux. We should probably go to that rather quickly. So identifying Linux to be able to use ASI Linux to the full extent, you should be able to determine where ASI Linux is. Makes sense, doesn't it? It also helps you. It also helps if you have basic understanding of its architecture. Now, this doesn't isn't quite as intimidating as it sounds. At least you do not have to know every gruesome detail. In this section, we will briefly discuss the three main components of ASI Linux and the architecture of ASI Linux. So briefly, we'll just briefly browse over the stuff. We're not going to explain the architecture of ASI Linux in great detail, but we're just briefly going to touch on some of the points that we want you to be aware about. And then later, we'll probably, or we will maybe, deal with that a little further. So when ASI Linux was submitted for inclusion, let me tell you this. So this is section one of subsection one of section two of paragraph one. ASI Linux implemented as a Linux security module. So I'm not sure if you know what Linux security modules are. It's basically a security framework in Linux, and this paragraph goes into that. So when ASI Linux was submitted for inclusion with the Linux kernel, it was decided to create a Linux security framework called Linux Security Modules and implement an LSM-based ASI Linux security module. So SE Linux is implemented, is an LSM based SE Linux security module. If you ask what is SE Linux, then you could basically answer with LSM based Linux security module. Of course, that's not the whole story, but it is a true fact. That's what it is. The idea was that security systems could be implemented, so, and that SE Linux would not have to be favored over any others optional security systems. So SE Linux would not have to be the only additional or optional security system. You could have like 10,000 Mac systems, and Linux should facilitate or enable the people implementing the kernel to decide which security system he wants to use. So that's basically what LSM enables. It's basically a system that enables you to compile in your security the security system that you want to use, because a lot of these security systems cannot be used together, so it's either one or the other, and so you need to be able to give the users or the people the ability to specify which security system they want to use. They can they want to use, and then so that's basically what the LSM does. The idea with blah blah blah. Today, a handful of optional security systems are available, and most of them are mutually exclusive. So you have this, you have Yama, you have AppArmor, you have a bunch of others. You could Google that. You can basically, if you there's some links here. Let's just click on these links. This is the Wikipedia article about Linux security modules, and it basically goes into that. So here, for example, GR Security. So obviously, or probably GR Security is also a LSM enabled security system. And here, AppArmor is mentioned. There should be a list somewhere of all the Linux security systems that are implemented via LSM. But anyways, read this. Otomoyo here also. But anyways, read this article. So that you'll know what it is. Alright, so let's get back to the book. And there's another link here. LSM based. Oh yeah, this is basically, this goes back to the NSA period gov site. Now, this site has a lot of great papers, and a lot of people are overlooking them. I'm not sure why. Most of these papers are pretty technical. They are not, I don't advise you to read these right away, although I did add the URLs or some URLs, but because they're really written from a researcher and a coder view, so it really goes into the deep Linux levels, where for example you need to know what IPC is and what IP networking is and stuff like that. And of course, eventually, if you want to be a real good SE Linux administrator, then you'll have to just know what all that stuff is, because you need to know what you secure. But anyways, for beginners, just bookmark it, and later on when you're more familiar with SE Linux, then just read it. It's great documentation, but it's really a dive into the deep if you don't have the base understanding. So today, that's, we already have that. To configure Linux, the Linux kernel to use as Linux as a default security system. All right, so that's where you specify whether that you want to use as Linux as your security system, your additional security system. Then the kernel should be built with config default security. Alternatively, you can specify security is as Linux on the kernel boot line, and that basically assumes that you have actually the SE Linux functionality included in your kernel. There might be even more, but these are the basics. This is basically the stuff that allows you to specify the security to use the LSM part, where you can basically specify as a human which security you want to use. So as a Linux is in your kernel, implement it as a Linux security module. As a Linux in the Linux kernel has three primary elements. We're going to briefly list these three parts. So here we're going into the architecture of Linux, or actually further into the architecture of SE Linux. You are not required to have a full understanding of the SE Linux architecture. And then we get another nice link to the NSA site with technical information that I don't encourage you to read right away, because it probably confuses you more than just needed. So just bookmark it, and later on when the basics are clear, you can basically click on these links and read them all, and they'll delve deeper into the technical details of the element, so to speak. So here are the three elements of SE Linux in the kernel. The security server. The SE Linux security server maintains security contacts and computes access decisions. And that's basically almost everything you need to know about security server. And you just need to know that a part of SE Linux in the kernel is a security server, an element of it, and that it maintains security contacts and computes access decisions. And then additionally, you can expand on that by saying it provides security policy decisions to object managers, permitting the object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. Of course, we haven't touched on object managers yet, neither have we touched on security contacts, and but just keep that in mind. It's very short and to the point. Don't expect you to be able to understand it. I just want to get you familiar with some of these terms. And so the next element if SE Linux in the kernel is the access vector cache. So what the hell is an access vector cache? Well, this component enables the caching of access vectors. Keep it simple. What are access vectors? We don't know, but we know that an access vector caches access vectors. That's all we need to know right now. And then there's a link which you should only click later once you get the basics out of the way. So what? And then we expand on that by saying stores access decisions access decision computations provided by the security server. So that's this guy here, for subsequent use by the object managers. So it's a caching mechanism. By storing these access decisions, earlier access decisions, the security server doesn't have to compute these access decisions all over again. So it prevents overhead, makes the system quicker and less resources. So it's basically a performance thing. All right, so element three of SE Linux in the kernel object manager. The kernel object manager manages a set of system resources. So that's basically what it is. It manages a set of system resources. Now, I know you really don't understand what that means. Just understand that it does. And then expand on that. Manages a set of system resources and enforces policy decisions over those resources. System resources. and that's important to understand kernel resources, better said. The policy decisions are obtained from the security server. So, again, you might really not know what it all means. Just know that there are three elements in the kernel, in SELinux in the kernel, and how these three elements relate to each other. So, where basically how the kernel object manager relates to the security server, how the access vector cache relates to the object manager, and how the security server relates to the access vector cache and the object manager, and that on a very broad level, on a very global level, without detail. Then later, that might be handy. It might come in handy, but really, from an administrator or a user point of view, you'll not deal with that stuff a lot. Of course, you need to be a little bit aware of it, but it's not something you need to be an expert about. Alright, so further, when SELinux is configured to be the default security system and is enabled, a security sudo file system will have been mounted traditionally under /SELinux. On older systems, like Red Hat Enterprise 6, which is the latest enterprise distribution with SELinux enabled by default, it's still in /SELinux. But on anything later, like Fedora 17 and up, and the upcoming Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7, and every other distro that implements current SELinux, the SELinux sudo file system will be under /sys/fs/SELinux. And this file system functions as an interface to SELinux. That's basically all you need to know. It's an interface to SELinux. And basically, users do not use the SELinux fs directly to interface to SELinux. It's the programs that, and we'll deal with that in the next subsection, it's the SELinux programs that basically interface to SELinux via the SELinux fs on behalf of you, not you directly. You could, I guess, but that's not, I don't recommend that. There's no need for that. So, comments on and patches to the current code, suggestions for improvements, and constructive criticism with regard to SELinux in the kernel are welcome at the SELinux mailing list, and here's a link to the SELinux mailing list. So, just so that you know that that's the place to discuss stuff, and it has a great archive that once you get the basics out of the way, that you can read, and you'll learn all about SELinux, and it's all free. And then there's two links, official SELinux pages, the most important ones, the SELinux NSA pages and the SELinux project wiki. Those are the two most important sites, so bookmark them. Bookmark them. Alright, so this is the section 2 of chapter 1, SELinux user space. So this is one or of the three components. So the first component of SELinux is SELinux in the kernel. The second component is the SELinux user space component. So this, then that's what it says. The second component of the SELinux project provides tools and libraries that complement SELinux in the kernel. So that's basically all you need to know. The SELinux user space component provides tools and libraries that complement SELinux in the kernel. Basically, the tools you need to interact or to operate on SELinux via the SELinux FS interfaces, so to speak. And the tools you need to make your, or the libraries, the tools you need to make your programs SELinux aware and capable to live in an Edge Linux environment, so to speak. Tools to compile policy, which we get into later. But here, basically, so let's just read it. We are not going to address all these tools and libraries. And here you have a link to a lot of these tools and libraries that you can click and look at. Instead, we will get familiar with the tools and libraries that are most common to users and administrators. So we're not going to touch on them all because it's easy to basically learn them yourself, read the man pages. But some of these tools are very common, and that those are the ones we're going to focus on later in the book. You are encouraged to peruse the tools and libraries yourself when you have read this book. The manual pages should give you an overview of their functionality and how they can be used. But these tools and libraries, so the Azure Linux user space provides the following capabilities, and then there's a broad overview. Policy compilation tools, tools that perform the conversion of text-based Azure Linux policy language into a format used by the kernel for enforcement. And later on in this book, we're going to delve pretty deep into this stuff. Policy management tools, tools used to install, remove, and update Azure Linux policies on running systems. We'll also deal with that later. Policy development tools, tools to aid in the creation and updating of policy. We'll also deal with that. Libraries for applications that must be aware of Azure Linux or enforce access control decisions using Azure Linux. At least touch a bit on that part as well. Utilities for working with and administration of Azure Linux enabled systems. And you're probably also already aware of some of these utilities. So, comments on and patches to the current code, suggestions for improvements and constructive criticism with regard to Azure Linux tools and libraries, aka Azure Linux user space, are also welcome on the Azure Linux user list. So if you want to discuss any of these tools or libraries, you're also welcome to come and discuss them on the Azure Linux mailing list, which is on the NSA, which is hosted by NSA. And there's an official Azure Linux tools and library page, the Azure Linux user space project page, it's on the Azure Linux project .org site, just for reference purposes. So you just bookmark them so that you know that where to go with regard to the second component of Azure Linux. So the third component of Azure Linux is policy. And this is really brief. The third component of Azure Linux is Azure Linux policy configuration. Note the configuration part in the policy configuration. This book will introduce you to Azure Linux policy configuration in great detail. For now, it is suffice to say that Azure Linux policy configuration is located in etc Azure Linux. That's all, I think, about policy. Just understand that policy is configuration data, and that configuration data is stored in etc Azure Linux. That's all you need to know right now. And of course, later on, things get a little bit more complicated, but for the first chapter, that's all it is. That's basically the third component of Azure Linux, the policy configuration. Alright, so that's it for the second section of the first paragraph. So let's go to the third section of the first chapter. So this is about security models, and this is something that a lot of people don't fully grasp. So let's see if we can make some sense out of this. Security models. In the first section of this chapter, we made the case for Azure Linux. The 5 points about why you should use Azure Linux. Azure Linux implements a set of security models to deal with specific challenges it aims to address. So it implements security models that help deal with specific challenges it aims to address. And Azure Linux aims to address the challenges discussed in section 1 of chapter 1. For example, integrity, confidentiality, and the centralized aspect of mandatory access control related to the discretionary access control with regard to traditional Linux security. So that's these are issues that it aims to address. And it is important to mention here that although the security modules that we're about to discuss are security modules that SE Linux implements by default, that although, yeah, that nothing stops you from implementing your own security modules, models instead. Sorry, I'm saying modules, I mean models. So that's important to understand. And in practice, you'll probably never ever implement your own security model. First, because it's just not really often not really needed, and the security models that are available basically deal with all the issues that you want to deal with when it comes to security. And second of all, it's not, it's possible to implement your own security model, but it's not straightforward, but it is possible. So although it might not be very practical to implement your own security models to address challenges that the default security models do not address, and it may be unlikely, it is possible due to the flexible nature of the SE Linux mandatory access control framework. So that's just a caveat. We're going to discuss security models in this chapter, but remember that you might at some point be seated at some computer system that has some security models that you never seen before, because there new security models would have been implemented, although chances are very unlikely, but could happen. So this section aims to provide a broad overview of the various policy models. In this book we will discuss, or we will focus on, the security models that are used by SE Linux by default in great detail. We will only briefly touch on the optional security models used by SE Linux, and let's just expand on that a little bit. And well, actually we'll expand on that later on, but just know that SE Linux knows some security models that it uses to basically deal with specific challenges that it aims to address. But not all of these security models are used by SE Linux by default. Some of them are optional. Alright, so that's enough to know for now. So let's go to the first security model that SE Linux implements by default, which is called the Identity-Based Access Control Security Model. This is one of those default models, so it's not optional. This is always used. And let's look at a little bit deeper in that. So the IBAC, which is basically, IBAC is the abbreviation of Identity-Based Access Control Security Model, is used by default. Well, that's what I said. This security model enables SE Linux to establish mappings or associations, quote, associations, unquote, between traditional Linux user identities or groups identities and SE Linux identities. Now, you know what Linux identities are, the Linux user ID and the group ID, but you don't know what SE Linux identities are. Just know that they're there, and you could basically, yeah, just keep it simple and just know that SE Linux enables you to define SE Linux identities and then establish an association between a SE Linux identity and a Linux identity, whether it's a user identity or a group identity. So it basically establishes a relationship, an association, a mapping. Traditional Linux security may not be aware of the presence of SE Linux, but SE Linux is aware of the presence of traditional Linux security or discretionary access control. These mappings are used by other security models like RBAC, which is an abbreviation for role-based access control, which we are about to discuss. MLS, which is an abbreviation for multi-level security, which we're about to discuss. And MCS. Basically, it's a vital security model. It's basically the model that associates all the other security models to traditional Linux security users. It's basically a bridge between traditional Linux security and SELinux. So that's basically what you can see, how you can approach that. So we will get to these security models next. So role-based access control. This is the second security model, and it's also a default security model. It's always used by default unless someone hacked it out of there and replaced it with another security model, which is always possible. But on the normal SELinux system, role-based access control is always used to some extent. So this security model works closely with the IBAC, which is the identity-based access control model, and the TE, type enforcement security models. And basically how that works is that role-based access control, or RBAC, enables us to grant access to sets of TE type enforcement rules to traditional Linux users or groups by mapping roles to SELinux user identities, and by mapping SELinux user identities or SELinux identities to traditional Linux user and group identities using IBAC, which is identity-based access control. So this is basically a bridge between type enforcement and users on the system, Linux users. Basically what it says, well, we're going to deal with type enforcement later, but type enforcement basically enforces integrity by basically allowing you to specify identifiers, type identifiers, and then assign that to processes, and then specify how each type identifier can interact or operate with another type identifier. And what role-based access control does is basically it allows a Linux user to get access to various sets of these type enforcement rules. So so that you can basically allow a user to switch to a different set of type enforcement rules. And I'm getting ahead of myself here, I know. Just understand that it is a bridge between users and type enforcement. It's a way to for us to basically allow a user to give different roles, and with roles we mean a different purpose, a different set of tasks. So you can have a web administrator and you can have a database administrator. Those are two different tasks, and you can basically assign these tasks to a single user or to different users, or just one task to one user and one task to another user. And the role-based access control security model enables us to basically assign roles to users, give users the permissions they need to perform a specific task or access to various roles. And we'll get to that later. But that is basically, those are the basics of role-based access control, delegating access to specific sets of rules. Alright, so subsection 3 of section 3 of chapter 1, type enforcement security model. This is also a default security model, always used by SELinux unless you hack that out and replace it with another security model, which is very unlikely, because it's due to its very important nature. Type enforcement is really the core security model of used by SELinux. Basically, role-based access control depends on type enforcement because it's using type enforcement to basically create these sets of rules. So type enforcement is really the core security model. So this security model enables for the enforcement of integrity. That's what I said a little bit early on. and allows you to restrict processes using sorry, type identifiers. I'm talking a lot. I need a drink. But let's see if I can do with a banana. So think about that. System resources are assigned types. So that's what I said with type identifiers. You can basically create a type identifier and assign it to a system resource. And rules govern how these type identifiers can operate on or interact with other security or system resources or other type identifiers. Access is denied by default. Also important to understand, as Linux does not allow anything by default. If you want something to be allowed, you need to specify it, always. If there is no rule specified that implicitly allows access, then access is denied by default. Alright. So the RBAC security model can be used to grant access to types or groups of types. That's what basically the relationship between RBAC and type enforcement is. That's basically what I explained. That the association between role-based access control and type enforcement. And yeah, so next the and so I went quick over type enforcement, but it's a hugely important security model, but we'll get to use it a lot later on. Subsection 4 of section 3 of chapter 1, user-based access control. Now this is the first optional security model that SLinux uses, so you don't have to use this. But what it does is it enables us to separate system resources based on SLinux identities. So SLinux allows us to create SLinux identities, which we can map to Linux identities. But we can also use that SLinux identity to separate system resources based on that SLinux identity. Let's say if one process has the SLinux identity of Joe, and the other process has the SLinux identity of Jane, then we can basically use the user-based access control to say that processes with the SLinux identity of Jane cannot access system resources that are labeled with the SLinux identity of Joe, and vice versa. So it provides a means of separation based on SLinux user identities or identities, SLinux identities. It's optional and it's not used very often, but it could be handy on shared Linux computer systems where you have, for example, a lot of local users and you want to basically separate them. Of course, you can use discretionary access control to some extent to basically separate that from a discretionary access control perspective, but this allows you to do that on a mandatory access control, on a centralized, on an operating system level. Alright. So, identity identifiers. So this can be useful to if you need to separate users, groups, and access to their resources. Alright, subsection 5 of section 3 of chapter 1, multi-level security. This is another optional security model. It's not enabled by default. This security model enables for the enforcement of confidentiality. So if you remember in chapter of in section one, we touched a little bit on how SE Linux enables us to enforce confidentiality. Well, this security model does that, enables that, but it's not enabled by default, so the enforcement of confidentiality is not done by default. And then we go going on to say that system resources are assigned security levels, sensitivity is part of a security level, which is a combination of sensitivities and compartments. Processes with higher sensitivities are not allowed to write to system resources with lower sensitivities, and processes with lower sensitivities are not allowed to read system resources with higher sensitivities. And we already discussed that in section one, basically a broad overview of the no read up and no write down concept of multi-level security. Additionally, this security model enables separation, so separation based on the compartment part of a security level. So we'll deal later with these terms, but just so that you understand that the identity-based access control also allows us to separate, but then based on user identities, and the multi-level security security model basically allows you to do separation, but then on the component part of the security level. So separation, but on a using a different security attribute. And I know that doesn't make sense to you probably, but we'll get to that later, hopefully. So that's basically what multi-level security does: enforcing confidentiality, enabling the control of over the flow of information in shared computer systems. Subsection 6, section 3, chapter 1, multi-category security. So this security model is also optional. It's not enabled by default, but a lot of systems do have it enabled. For example, Red Hat distributions do have it enabled by default. And this enables us to separate system resources based on the compartment part of a security level. So think about that. It's basically multi-level security without the enforcement of sensitivity level sensitivities, because the sensitivity is a part of a security level. Sensitivities and compartments, those two components make up a sensitivity level, security level. But what multi-category does, it basically takes out the sensitivity part and only uses the compartment part. So where MLS uses both sensitivities and compartments, MLS only uses compartments to separate system resources. And it also uses probably a slightly different set of rules, but it's both separation and probably pretty much the same, although not sure, but it's just basically for separation based on compartments. So we have IBAC that does separation based on SE Linux identities. We have multi-level security that does separation based on compartments, but also enforces the flow of information using sensitivities. And we have multi-category that just only uses the compartment part of the security level to enable for separation. So the sensitivity part of the security level is not used by the MCS security model. So that's what I said. It's only using the compartment part of the security level and not the sensitivity. So there's no no read up and no write down, so to speak. So the IBAC security model, the identity-based security model, is used to map compartments or ranges of compartments to SE Linux identities. Oh, and I forgot to mention that. So again, the I'm confusing a little bit earlier. UBAC uses the as Linux uses to separate. IBAC is the security model used to map to make an association between SE Linux and Linux. So basically, the IBAC, the identity-based security model, is just used with the optional multi-level security and multi-category security models, security models, because we're using the identity to basically map sets of categories or sets of security levels, sensitivities, to SE Linux users, and then we are IBAC enables us to create an association between SE Linux users and Linux users. So basically, what it does, it eventually it allows us to assign security levels or categories to Linux users using the identity-based access control model. So if you can see, it's all associated. This SE Linux is all about associating, grouping, labeling. So what is SE Linux about? It's about labeling, grouping, and associating. That's the most important thing to know about SE Linux. And then there's a note here, compartments are also referred to as categories. So it's called multi-category security, but you could have might as well have called it multi-compartment security. It's the same thing. So that's another thing you see in SE Linux. You see all these terms used intermixed. And another example is the term domain. Some people use the term domain, others use the term domain type, and so, but, and then that can be confusing. But just know that compartments can also be referred to categories. So if I'm saying category, I'm saying compartment. If I'm saying compartment, I'm saying category. That might be handy for later. So I think that's it for section 3 of chapter 1. So we're at section 4, which is the last section of the first chapter. SE Linux is a labeling system. Now, I cannot overstate the importance of labeling to SE Linux, and I mentioned that a little bit earlier. SE Linux is all about labeling, grouping, and associating. And labeling is very important. So, SE Linux assigns labels with security metadata to system resources. So, SE Linux assigns labels with security metadata to system resources. Access decisions are computed based on these labels. So, it is important that system resources are labeled correctly to make sure that they are classified properly. This section provides an overview of SE Linux labeling. So if the labeling isn't right, then you can't expect SE Linux to make the right decisions, because SE Linux makes basis decisions on labeling, on the labels of sources and targets in interaction or operation. So subsection 1 of section 4 of chapter 1, the SE Linux security context, important. So SE Linux labels are called security contexts. And in section 2, we briefly mentioned the term security context. So SE Linux are called security labels are called security contexts. Now, each security context has at least 3 fields separated by columns. So let me just show you that clear ID. IDC will just get me the context. Now, what I was saying is that each security context has at least 3 fields separated by columns. So, 1, 2, and 3. I said at least. Some systems have a fourth field, like my Fedora or Red Hat Enterprise Linux has it as well. So keep in mind the colons, and then there is another colon here. So basically, if you literally followed me up, then you would basically say, well, you're lying to me, because there's no four, there are five fields, because if they're separated by colons, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But this is a special case, and I also discussed that and said, well, if you want to make it intuitive, then you should basically not use this colon here. But just note that in this case, this is basically one field. So we have four fields here. But in a typical or in a normal as a Linux system, you only have three fields, because the last field is used by optional security models. All right, so let's not get ahead of ourselves. So where are we? Okay, so for those familiar with databases or database terminology, you can compare them to tuples. In the database tuples, you also have these fields separated by colons. Each field is a security attribute that maps to one or more security models. So this is an important thing to understand. So let's go back. So each field, so I'm not actually talking about how the field is filled in. So I'm not talking about, in this case, unconfined underscore u per se, but just the field. Is a security attribute, which maps or associates to one or more security models. We discussed the security models. We discussed them all the known security models. So each of these fields basically associate to a security to at least one security model, and in some cases even more. But what you see, these fields are filled in. But they are filled in, these security attributes are filled in with security identifiers. So what you actually see are identifiers that are filled into the security attributes, and the security attributes, and thereby also the security identifiers, map to security models. So let's go ahead and see if. So by default, the first field in a security tuple is called a identity security attribute. So the first field in a security tuple, so before the first colon, that's a security attribute. The second one is a basically this is kind of confusing, but the second is a role security attribute, and the third field is a type security attribute, and the fourth field is a security level security attribute. So just keep that in mind. Security context is the whole. The fields are security attributes separated by colons, and what you actually see inside these fields are identifiers. It's important to understand the difference between that, and each of these security attributes associate to the discussed security models. So for example, this identity security attribute associates to identity based access control, and optionally to user-based access control, because that's an optional security model. So basically, this field can be used for two security models concurrently. The second role security attribute is used by role-based access control only, as far as I know. And the third security, the types security attribute, is used by type enforcement security model, which is basically the core default security model employed by SLinux. And the fourth security attribute, which is as a whole called a security level security attribute, is used by both the MLS as well as the MCS optional security models. So you might not see this one at all in your system, but if either MCS or MLS security models are enabled, then you'll see this field. It's also important to note that the MLS and MCS security optional security models are mutually exclusive, so you can't have both. Either you have MCS or you have MLS. Basically, it makes sense if you think about the two security models, because MCS doesn't use the sensitivity part of a security level, so it can never be used with MLS, because MLS uses the sensitivity level, so they're inherently mutually exclusive. Alright, so let's not get ahead of ourselves. Used by user base so yeah, now let's just read it up. So by default, the first field in a security context tuple called an identity security attribute is used by the default IBAC security model, identity-based access control security model, used by SLinux. If SLinux also has the UBAC security module model enabled, which is optional, then this identity security attribute is also used by the user-based access control security model. So if UBAC is enabled, then the first field in the security context tuple is used by two security models, the IBAC and the UBAC security models. The second field in a security context, called a role security attribute, is used by the default role-based access control security model, used by SLinux. The third field in a security context tuple is called a type security attribute and is used by the default type enforcement security model by SLinux. So, if either the MLS or MCS security models are enabled, which are mutually exclusive security models, so that's basically what I said a little bit earlier, they are mutual exclusive, MLS and MCS, then your security context has a fourth field, and that's what I'm showing you here. This is the fourth field, which is the security level field, the security level type, security level security attribute. Yeah, all these lingos are pretty hard, but it's good to learn them. Okay, so the security level security attribute is used by multi-level security and multi-category security by SLinux. Alright, so that's it. And then there's a note, although the sensitivity and compartment parts of security level security attributes are also delimited by a column, it is important to know that a combination of the two is still a single field in a security context. So let's just expand on that a little bit more. So I told you that this last field, that the security context has four fields, but that this last field is misleading because there is a column in here. And what this column does is it actually separates, or basically puts a border between the sensitivity part and the compartment or category part of a security level. So these are the sensitivities, and these are the compartments or categories. And that's basically why this is using the same colon delimiter. So that's, but it's one, it's basically one security attribute, which is the security level. But the security level is basically split into two security models. Yeah, that sounds really complex. Man, I wonder why that if come to think about it, I wonder why that is. And basically, actually, in practice, it you could probably argue that they are both separate security attributes, but for some reason in the implementation they decided nope, this is one security attribute, but it's basically delimited by categories and sensitivities. So that's some kind of weird thinking. So that's just something you need to keep in mind. There's other things in SLinux that you need to keep in mind that you think on, but that doesn't make sense, but you just need to accept that it's the way that it is. And so this is the fourth field. It's called a security level, and it has sensitivities, and it has compartments, and even this single security attribute is delimited by a colon, just like all the other security attributes. So that sucks a little. If you're an if you're suffering from autism, you'll probably won't like that a lot. Now I'm not suffering from autism though, but I'm still annoyed by it a little bit. Anyways, so the security the SLinux framework enables us to specify security identifiers to associate to each security attribute and label system resources with combinations of these security identifiers. Let me repeat that. The SLinux framework enables us to specify security identifiers to associate to each security attribute and label system resources with combinations of these security identifiers. So I said that for one security context, four fields. Each field is a security attribute which maps to one or more security models. But what you see in these fields are security identifiers. The strings that you actually see are identifiers that are filled in to the fields which are security attributes. So that's just important to understand, because SLinux allows you to create identifiers, associate them to security attributes, and thereby allowing you to associate your specified, your defined security identifiers to security models. So you can use your identifiers to create rules pertaining to the various security models. So you can basically, so that's basically what it is. So and you do that by basically assigning sets of security identifiers, basically assigning a security context to system resources. So that's basically what I'm saying here. Am I not? Yeah, so basically it enables us to specify security identifiers, so we can create security identifiers, and we can then associate our security identifiers to a security attribute, and then label system resources with combinations of these security identifiers. And with that I'm saying label system resources with security context as a whole. Alright, so this is important again. Alright, so subsection 2 of section 4 of chapter 1, how system resources are labeled. System resources are labeled in one of four ways. In this section we will have a brief look at each of these four ways. So the first way to that system resources are labeled is by using SLinux policy language. Basically the SLinux policy language provides transition rules that enable us to tell SLinux what a system resource should be labeled. These rules can only be used for labeling of files if the file is to be created. Similarly, these transition rules can only be used for labeling of processes if the process is to be executed. We will look at transition rules in greater detail. So just note that you can basically label with transition rules. That's basically what you take away from this chapter. And then secondly, you can label using security context specifications. So you can basically, there's a you can basically specify how a system resource should be labeled, and that doesn't work for processes though, but it works for files and other objects like links and directories, but also for ports. And you can specify how these objects should be labeled, and this is mostly used as a kind of a fallback, so that as Linux knows that as Linux can look at the list and say, okay, this file should be labeled that, so then you can basically relabel it and reset it to what is system wide, what is specified system wide. So basically, a list of paths associated to contacts, and as Linux can use that list to determine how a particular path should be labeled. So as Linux contacts can be specified either in as Linux policy or by using the SEManage or chkon commands, and the chkon commands would probably go here, but anyway, the SEManage command allows you to add file context specifications. You can do SEManage and then dash A and then dash T and then the type identifier and then the path, and then it adds it to the list of file context specifications. As Linux policy can be used to restrict the functionality of the, and that's a chkon command, but this chkon command should go into the third way of labeling. So let's go to the third. So this is basically just a large list of paths with associated file contacts. Three, SELinux library function. So the SELinux library function library provides functions to enable applications to create files and processes with specified security contacts. Sorry. As a Linux policy enables us to restrict this functionality on an operating system level. So, for example, the we talked about the as a Linux user space component of as a Linux that provides tools and libraries. Well, the lib as a Linux package basically has functions that programs can use, call, to do specific SE Linux stuff. But it you can allow from a system operating system level, you can allow a program to set a security context. So you can have a program that basically has some built-in lib SE Linux functions and says, okay, create this file with this context on a application level. Of course, that must also be allowed by the SE Linux policy on a system-wide level to be allowed. So that's important to understand. So the same with the chkon command. Chkon command isn't a function, but it's a tool provided by the SE Linux user space component. It allows the one who runs chkon to basically change the context of a file. But the policy must also allow that you change to the specified identifier and change from the old identifier. So basically the command itself, the chkon command itself, just does it, and the policy determines whether it's allowed or not, and if it's not allowed, it blocks it. So also important to understand, a lot of people aren't aware of the library functions, and also not aware of how the chkon command works. That just because you have access to the chkon command doesn't mean that you can just change to any context. No, that's basically governed by the policy. Whether you are allowed to change to a specified identifier or set of identifiers, whether or not. Okay, we'll build on that later. You'll see that later. So initial security identifier. So we talked about identifiers, security identifiers. Again, if you look at this security context, one security context, four fields, Each field represents a security attribute, and what you actually see in these fields are security identifiers. So we also have something that's called an initial security identifier. So normal security identifiers are created by the policy administrator. You can basically create a new identifier and then assign that to a security attribute, and thus assign that or associate that to a security model. But there are initial security identifiers, and the difference between initial security identifiers and security identifiers is that initial security identifiers are hard-coded into SELinux. So SELinux does not allow you to specify that, it's just built in. So initial security identifiers are used by SELinux during system initialization or for predefined system resources. They are also used as a failsafe to label system resources that would otherwise have no or an invalid label. More on initial security identifiers later. So, and that then we're going on in the next chapter. So let's just go on. So just this is just a small description. System initialization and predefined system resources and failsafe. And then subsection 3 of section 4 of chapter 1, initial security identifiers. SELinux allows us to create security identifiers and to associate them to the various security attributes. That's what I said earlier. This allows us to specify rules that apply to the security identifiers. Period. SELinux also has a set of default security identifiers, or initial security identifiers. They are built in SELinux. So unlike normal security identifiers, which are specified by us, the initial security identifiers are built in. We are going to look at two initial security identifiers that Linux administrators are likely to encounter. So we're not going to deal with each security identifier. We're going to focus on the ones that you are likely to encounter, and if you encounter them, that you can determine why it's there and what you should do about it. So the first initial security identifier is called the unlabeled initial security identifier. This initial security identifier is assigned by SELinux automatically to processes and files that currently have one or more invalid security identifier. Think about that. So let's just repeat that one. This initial security identifier is assigned by SELinux automatically to processes and files that currently have one or more invalid security identifier. If you see processes or files with the unlabeled underscore T type initial security identifier, then you know that at least one of the security identifiers in the security context is invalid, and that this should be fixed by using one of the four ways to label system resources, which we discussed in the previous example, the four ways to label system resources. Ideally, you should never see security context with the unlabeled underscore T ISID, which is an abbreviation for initial security identifier. So if you see, and I'm going to touch on a practical example here. So one practical example of this is if you remove a security identifier from the policy that was in use. So for example, you have a process running with a type security identifier of my process underscore T, and that process is running, and while it's running you decide to remove that type from the policy. So you'll basically just remove the declaration, the type declaration, and now I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, but you remove that type from the policy, so the type, and then load the new policy into the system, so the type no longer exists. But there is still that process running with that old type, which no longer exists. So SELinux, what SELinux does is it notices that and it says, okay, this process runs with a type that's invalid. The type doesn't exist. And then as Linux uses the unlabeled underscore T initial security identifier to basically label the type security attribute of a security context of that process that has an invalid security identifier. So when you see that, then basically you could basically for if when you see a process or a file with the unlabeled T identifier, then you know that one of the fields in the security context of that file of process has an identifier that is invalid for some reason. So you need to figure out which identifier in that security identity might be invalid and for what reason, and then just use one of the four ways to label system resources to fix it. And then the second initial security identifier is the file initial security identifier. This initial security identifier is assigned by SE Linux automatically to files that currently have no SE Linux label at all. So unlike the unlabeled security identifier, which is assigned by SE Linux automatically to system resources that have an invalid security identifier, aka an invalid SE Linux label, this one is assigned to system resources automatically that have no label at all or security context at all. So if you see files with the file T type initial security identifier, then you know that the file has no security context. And the solution is to apply labeling to the file using one of the four ways to label system resources. And you see this pretty often. For example, people use partitions between various operating systems. For example, what you see often is people that use Ubuntu want to share the Ubuntu home directory with their Fedora system home directory. So basically they have this Ubuntu system with a home directory, but Ubuntu doesn't use SE Linux, so there is no labeling, persistent labeling, and that's another chapter, we'll get into persistent label. There's no labeling metadata assigned to the file system and the files on the file system. And then basically he mounts it into his Fedora SE Linux enabled system, and then all the files in his home directory get type file T. That's because the files are unlabeled. They don't have a label because the file system was created and used in Ubuntu, and Ubuntu doesn't use SE Linux, so doesn't apply the labeling. And so if you see file T, restore the context is usually the easy solution. Another solution would be to mount the file system, the partition, with a security context, which the mount command allows you to specify a security context to use to mount a file system. So that basically enables you to assign a security context to a partition or to a file system without actually using persistent storage of file context. And we're getting to persistent storage of file context later, but you could either restore the context, and then SE Linux will look at the list of security context specifications, which I discussed earlier, and then the restore con command will restore the context according to the list of system-wide security context specifications, or you could use the mount command and just mount with a security context, and then the security context will be assigned to the files non-persistently. But of course you'll also need access to use the context to use with the mount command, just like you need access to reset the context using the restore command from a operating system level. So one practical example is example I explained with Ubuntu, for example. So there are various other initial security identifiers. For example, kernel underscore T is an initial security identifier associated to kernel threads, because kernel threads need to be labeled before security policy is loaded. So the security policy has these declarations of these security identifiers. But these kernel threads need to be labeled before the policy is even loaded. So therefore, the kernel underscore t initial security identifier is basically hard-coded into SE Linux so that they can be labeled before the policy is actually loaded. So as an administrator, however, only the two initial security identifiers listed above are important to be aware of. Those, the file t and the underscore, the unlabeled underscore t, are the most commonly encountered initial security identifiers. And now you know what to do. Alright, so subsection 4 of section 4 of chapter 1, persistent storage of labels. So there's a way to actually store security contexts persistently on file systems that allow that. Because SE Linux can store security metadata persistent on file systems that support extended attributes. So it only applies if your file system supports extended attributes. And if SE Linux is aware of that file system type. So you store it persistently. So you store the security context persistently on the files using extended attributes. So support for extended attributes for a particular file system also needs to be enabled in the Linux kernel for this to work, obviously, because SE Linux uses extended attributes to store these security contexts persistently on SE Linux extended attributes enable file systems, so it needs to be enabled, the extended attributes. Persistent storage of labels enables you to use existing SE Linux security metadata across SE Linux enabled systems without the need for relabeling. So you can basically switch out your hard drive and then just put it in another system that has SE Linux enabled with the same policy, and then mount partitions, and then the labeling should have been persisted. The identifiers used for labeling this content must exist in the other SE Linux enabled systems security policy, or else unlabeled initial security identifier will kick in. But that's obvious. The type, if for example you use one type on one system and then you put out the hard drive and put it in another system that also has SE Linux but doesn't know that type, and you mount the system, then that type becomes invalid, and SE Linux will kick in and label the type with the unlabeled T because one of the identifiers was invalid. Alright, so the security context is stored as an extended attribute using the SE Linux period, the security period SE Linux extended attribute name. And labels can be get and set using get f attribute and set f attribute commands respectively. Although usage of those commands for working with and administration of SE Linux is not recommended, instead there are SE Linux tools available that can be used to achieve similar results, which will be discussed later. SE Linux policy can be used to restrict this functionality on an operating system level. All right. So, and then there's an example of how you can use get f attribute command to get the SE Linux period, security period SE Linux security attributes of a file called book notes on my file system, and then it basically returns this string, which is basically the security context. Here you see the four fields again, 1, 2, 3, 4, the security context assigned to the file book notes text. And I think we're there. Yeah, we're here. So now we have basically all the basics out of the way. Now, if you understand what I've been explaining to you, then you should have a solid basis for the remaining chapters in this book. And then there's a summary here, why we need secure operating systems, because we can't trust programs and users. We need to be able to manage security on a different level, on a higher level or on a lower level, depends on how you look at it. Why we need to be able to override decentralized discretionary security with centralized security, because, well, the creator of a file might not be the actual owner of the file. Why we need to be able to restrict processes, because without SE Linux, processes are run with access permissions, and the more you have, the more can break. Controlling the flow of information in shared computer systems, confidentiality, you need to know about that, MLS. Strong points of SE Linux compared to traditional Mac systems, configurability and flexibility. Purpose of Linux security models. The purpose is to not favor one over the other and enable the end user to specify which security system he uses. Purpose of the SE Linux security server, maintaining context and calculating computing access decisions. Purpose of access factor cache, caching access factors. Purpose of the object manager, managing objects and access to them, something like that. Purpose of the SE Linux file system, that's an interface to SE Linux. Serves as an interface to SE Linux. Broad description of capabilities of various SE Linux tools and libraries. Policy compilation tools, policy loading tools, utilities, SE Linux functions, blah blah. Where SE Linux policy is stored in etc SE Linux. The three components of SE Linux is SE Linux in the kernel, SE Linux user land utilities, aka the tools and libraries, and SE Linux policy. What a security model is a way for SE Linux to achieve to address a challenge. The aim of the IBAC, identity based security model, is basically to establish an association between SE Linux and traditional Linux security. The aim of the role-based access security model is basically to be able to assign sets of permissions to users, using type enforcement. So how identity-based access control helps role-based access control achieves its goal. Identity-based access control creates an association between SE Linux users and Linux users, and SE Linux users allow you to create an association between roles and SE Linux users. So you can map a set of roles to an SE Linux user, and then you can use IBAC to create an association between SE Linux users and Linux users. So eventually you can basically, it allows you to basically say, okay, this Linux user should have access to these roles, two sets of permissions, so to speak, depending on, he can choose a role depending on what task he is about to do. So the aim of the security e-security model is basically enforcing integrity, basically restricting processes to exactly what they need to do, nothing more, nothing less. How TE helps role-based access control achieve its goal. So basically, role-based access control allows you to specify roles, sets of rules, and these rules are specified using type enforcement. Basically, rules that use the type identifiers to specify how one type identifier can operate on or interact with another type identifier. The aim of user-based access control security module is separating processes, or let's just say separating system resources based on the identity security attribute or the SE Linux user identity, so it's same thing. Relationship of UBAC and IBAC security models, they both share the same security attribute. They both use SE Linux identities to achieve their, or to meet their challenge, to address that challenge. Aim of the MLS security model is to enable for the control of the flow, over the flow of information in shared computer systems. How identity-based access control helps MLS achieves its goal. IBAC allows you to basically IBAC allows you to associate SE Linux users to security levels, or security levels to SE Linux users, and IBAC allows you to associate as Linux users to Linux users. So in fact, basically, you are enabled to basically say this Linux user has access to these security levels or to this security level. That's basically what it boils down to. So the aim of the MCS security model is basically allow for separation using the compartment or category attribute, security attribute, just how you want to call it. How IBAC helps MCS achieves its goal, well, the same as in the case of MLS, except that IBAC enables you to basically map categories or compartments to as Linux users, and allows you to map as Linux users or associate as Linux users to Linux user identities and groups. Relationship of MLS and MCS security models. They both use the same security attribute, namely the security level security attribute. They're both mutually exclusive, by the way. The three default security models are identity-based access control, role-based access control, type enforcement. The three optional security models are user-based access control, multi-level security, and multi-category or multi-compartment security. The purpose of labels to as Linux to store security metadata to system resources, I guess. Yeah, what security contexts are? Well, security contexts are basically tuples with fields, and each field is a security attribute that is an association to one or more security models. And each field, you are allowed to or enabled to create security identifiers and associate each security identifier that you create to a security attribute in the security context. What security attributes are is basically a field in the security context tuple. So, and a security attribute is basically one of the four fields in a security attribute. I guess that's how I would say it. How many security attributes a security context can have? Well, I said it already. Four. How security attributes are related to security models? Well, they map to each other. They associate. How they relate? They associate to each other, I guess. Yeah. Name the four security attributes. Well, the identity security attribute, the role security attribute, the type security attribute, and the security level security attribute. Relationship of MCS, MLS security models to the security level attribute. Well, they both share the same security level attribute, but the MCS only uses the MCS the category compartment part of the security level security attribute, and MLS uses also the sensitivity part of the security level security attribute. Relationship of security identifiers to security attributes. Well, you can basically create security identifiers and assign them to security or associate them to security attributes. Four ways how system resources can be labeled. They can be labeled using as Linux policy language, using the transition rules. They can be labeled using file context specifications, basically a list with paths and security contexts, basically one huge list. And then it can be labeled using functions as Linux functions or tools. So for example, the tcon command, or and that's more advanced, the setfs create con function, or the setcon function. And the fourth way is using initial security identifiers. Where are we? The purpose of initial security identifiers, well, that's basically used for initialization, or for fixed resources, or for fail safe. The purpose of the unlabeled initial security identifier is basically a fail safe for contexts that have invalid security identifiers. The purpose of the file initial security identifier is a fail-safe for system resources that have no security identifiers at all, no security context at all. The relationship between SELinux labels and extended attributes. Extended attributes allow us to store SELinux labels persistently on file systems. The name of the extended attribute SELinux uses to store labels is security period SELinux. Alright, so I'm just going to leave it at that. This should give you a pretty solid basis. It only touches the surface, but it's a important surface indeed. So I'm going to leave it at that. It's been a long